Well, hello, everyone. Welcome to this webinar. It promises to be a big webinar with people from all over the world, and we're delighted to have all of you. The subject of the webinar is mapping the new economy, mapping the next system. And the event is proudly sponsored by the Next System Project, a project of the Democracy Collaborative, the Real Economy Lab, and we'll hear from Jules Peck about that shortly, and by the New Economy Coalition, mostly U.S. groups now, 140 so organizations focused on building a new economy. My name is Gus Speth. I'll be moderating this, and I'm the co-chair of the Next System Project, along with Garl Perovitz. I've been a dean at Yale and various other things along the way. So how do we put the theme of the event? I guess I'd put it this way. Amid all the truly awful situations and events around us today, we can also see the launching of a large number of organizations and concrete on-the-ground initiatives pointing towards a better world, a just transition, a new economy, a next system. In short, a new system of political economy that transcends the past, embraces system change, and has as its core values the flourishing of real people in real places on our beleaguered planet. And so our job today in the webinar is to better understand and map these innovative organizational initiatives and these the new concrete, on-the-ground things that people are actually doing. How can we strengthen our emerging community? How can we look towards the evolution of a powerful international movement for deep change and for a new system? So here are the five questions that we want to attend to in the next 2 hours. The first, what are the main challenges and impediments that we face in scaling up, in unifying, and in building a movement? Secondly, what values and principles and goals unite us, motivate us, and perhaps in some cases separate us? How aligned are we? Number three, how can we build better collaboration among our organizations and develop into a coherent movement? Number four, where are we seeing inspiring successes happening now? And how do we measure progress of our movement? And lastly, to focus specifically on the first presentation, how can the Real Economy Lab help the community as a whole? What tools and data and support do we need to move forward together? So these are obviously big questions, questions that we will only begin to answer in this seminar, webinar, but it's good to start, and it's good to have so many organizations together and so many individuals together tuning in as this next system new economy movement emerges. We're going to break the conversation into roughly halves. We'll begin with three presenters, whom I'll introduce momentarily. Then we'll have a question and answer on those three. You can submit questions, and if there are too many questions, our moderators are going to forward a selection onto me, and I will put those questions to our panelists. It would be best, but not essential, if you would direct your questions to one or two of the panelists. Then, after the first hour, we'll move into the second, and we have two panelists in the second hour for a total today of five, and there'll be Q&A after the second panelists. The panelists have been asked to take about 7 minutes each to make their presentations. But since the work of the Real Economy Lab is in many ways the centerpiece here today, Jules Peck, the first presenter, might end up taking a little bit longer. I must say, I'm not familiar with the work of all of the panelists, so when I did my homework and went to their websites and their information, I must say I was enormously impressed. We have a really outstanding group of panelists today. They're enormously talented and deeply engaged, and we're very lucky to have them. So here are our first three panelists, which I will introduce together, and then let them go off on their own in the order of their introduction. Jules Peck is convener of the Real Economy Lab, a trustee of the New Economics Foundation in England, and an associate of the Futures Company. He's been engaged in the new economy activities and related things for a long time, and you'll be, I think, pretty amazed as I was when you see what the Real Economy Lab has done. The second presenter will be my friend Ed Whitfield, who's a leader in the North Carolina-based Fund for Democratic Communities, and it's Southern Grassroots Economies Project, and its work on participatory democracy. And Ed is also a member of the board of the New Economy Coalition. And thirdly, we will have a presentation by Michelle Bowens, a leading peer-to-peer theorist and an active writer and researcher and speaker on the links between technology and culture and business innovation. If you haven't seen the website, commonstransition.org, it's also amazing. So that's our lineup for the first hour. And Jules, why don't you take it away?
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Gus. So I'm being very low-tech here, I'm afraid. I can't actually see my slides, but hopefully, has my first slide been put up? Okay, fantastic. So thank you very much, Gus. So I'm going to be talking about some work that we've been doing at the Real Economy Lab. The headline of what we're doing is that we're trying to act as a connector of change makers in the next economy space. If we could go to the next slide, please. So a quote here from you, Gus, and from your partner, Gar Alperovitz, basically summarizing the way I see this space, which is that there really is an explosion of grassroots changing theory and practice going on all around the world in terms of the next economy space. I'll talk about a few of those initiatives. We've probably got many of them online today, but if we could have the next slide. The real question that we wanted to focus on with the Real Economy Lab was how do we understand who's actually doing what, why they're doing it, how do we make sense of this emerging ecosystem of theory and practice all around the world on what you could call the new or next economy. You know, does it add up to more than the sum of its parts? Those are the sorts of questions that we're trying to answer in the Real Economy Lab. Next slide. So just quickly, a little bit about our theory of change, and I think this is a series of assumptions that we'll probably all agree with. Our current system is clearly in structural crisis, and there's a growing crisis of legitimacy, and there's a real appetite for change. But what we know about the way paradigm shift happens is that it requires not just a critique of the current system, it requires a practical and exciting vision of the alternative. And I think a lot of people would agree that the problem right now is that most NGOs and funders and much of civil society are acting on what could be called low-order leverage points in terms of Donata Meadows' theory of change and minor reforms, and they're not going to take us to what we need, which is true paradigm shift. But there is this existing rich fabric of alternatives that are going on around the world, as yet unconnected. And as I said, our theory of change is about trying to help those connect. Next slide, please. Okay, so what's needed? Well, what we're trying to do is build up an ecosystem perspective on how transition is happening across hundreds, probably thousands of organizations and platforms and paradigms around the world, and try and make sense of this in terms of the way this is emerging right around the globe. Next slide, please. So we're a collaborative investigation. We're trying to work with many, many partners. Next System Project is just one of the many partners we're working with to try and understand, map, and illustrate how this ecosystem is evolving, to be a connector of both practice and theory around the world. So the headlines of that is that we're connecting, converging, and hopefully catalyzing new change. Next slide, please. So we've developed an early stage taxonomy of what we're calling tribes. Those are sort of meta groups across the next economy, and we've listed those up here. These we've put together through consultation with people around the next system, the next economy space, as well as analysis we've done through surveying. So things like commons orientated, P2P networks, enterprise-based models, government and politics. There's a lot of detail here. I'm really rushing through it. Next slide, please. So what we've done, our initial work was based on a survey, which, can we have the next slide up, please, which just shows a snapshot of the survey. We sent out a survey to about 200 organizations that we were aware of around the world who were operating in those sorts of spaces, and asked them to fill out the survey. There's about 30 questions in the survey, details of that online, and we can discuss a few more details of it later on, perhaps in the Q&A. Those responses to those survey questions then came back and went into a database. Next slide shows some of the sorts of attributes, some of the sorts of issues we were looking at. So the structure of the organization, what sectors they're trying to influence, their geographic outreach, any explicit positions they may have had on issues like capitalism, growth, the means of operating, the areas they want to work in. Is it just the finance sector, or is it right across the economy? Their view on certain political economic paradigms. So are they in line with a market socialist or non-market socialist paradigm, or a new cooperative paradigm, and so forth. So those are some of the sorts of issues that we were looking at in our questionnaire. And here's the next slide, shows just a sort of snapshot of some of the initial tribes. Now, bear in mind, this is all beta work. We're proof of concept phase at the moment with this initial survey. These are some examples of the kinds of organizations around the world that we reached out to and asked them to fill in the questionnaire. And as I said, we had about a 25-30% response rate, which was pretty good considering nobody had ever heard of us and it was a pretty new idea. Next slide. We see that there are some emerging themes coming out across the next economy. So, for instance, cooperation and solidarity leapt out as a very strong theme, awareness and education, transparency and accountability. So by analyzing the responses that came in to the survey, we started, next slide, also to determine that there were certain kind of there were certain archetypes we could start to see emerging. Many organizations may be one or more of these archetypes. They could be a disruptor, a visioner, a pioneer, an activator. And these are archetypes we came up through analyzing the data that came through in a way to try and start to see who are the types of organizations who ought to be connected to each other, who are similar to each other. And perhaps if they're not connected to each other, how can we help them collaborate and connect together and catalyze new action? The next slide. At this stage, surveyed 200 organizations around the world in the next economy space, and built a data set of information which is now online, available online as a a visual map of the interactivity between all these actors, their theories of change, what they're working on, their position on all sorts of issues, with the idea of trying to help them connect with each other and collaborate with each other and see how that ecosystem is evolving. It's proof of concept at this stage, available on www.realeconomylab.org. So the next phase that we're about to start off in early 2016 is that we're going to be going out and surveying a much larger number of players around the next economy space, actors and thinkers and practitioners. And we hope to have about 200 organizations on the next version of the meta maps. We'll then be collaborating with organizations like Next System Project to run hopefully more successful webinars where the technology functions, as well as we're hoping to collaborate with Next System Project and others on a sort of global gathering of next economy players around the world in 2016 to discuss some of the issues that are emerging from this mapping of this ecosystem. So that's probably all I need to say at this stage without unfortunately being able to show the visual maps. If people can go to the link of the Kumu, which hopefully Noel has shared as well, that Kumu, it's basically an online presentation. It gives you a way to go into the an example of one of the mind maps of the next economy. Gives you an overview of the actors and some feeling of the functionality of the mind maps, the meta maps that we'll have online and that we already have online, but particularly the next version of the meta map that will be online next year, and some examples, particularly of the P2P Foundation and how they connect with other players. So that's probably all I'll say at this stage, Gus.
I have a question for you. As I understand it, what you have mapped and analyzed are organizations.
And, that's right.
And that what we need to add to this at some point is a mapping also of particular on the ground initiatives that these and other organizations are carrying out.
And absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, we've identified, you know, hundreds just of kind of organizations who sit between these meta tribes of the commons or P2P, the sharing economy, corps, open corps, and so forth. But, you know, obviously a much, much richer layer beneath that is the individual initiatives. You know, if you take transition towns as one example, at a meta level, it's one global tribe. But, of course, there are now, you know, hundreds, if not, I forget the number, possibly thousands of transition towns around the world. So you're right, but that makes it much, much more complex to start trying to include those organizations into this mapping, which I should emphasize, this is not a geographic mapping. It's a mapping of theories of change, principles, values, activities, objectives, and so forth. It's a detailed overlaying of all those issues for all of the organizations we've been surveying.
This is Gus again. Ed, you are up next.
I will go. I'm ready. The problems of modern technology.
Yeah. Right.
Anyway, what I'd like to talk about briefly is kind of at the root of the problems that we're facing worldwide, both economically as well as ecologically. I think lies in the fact that the Earth, our common heritage, is not being democratically managed for the benefit of all, but it rather has been appropriated by a handful of people who, looking forward to short-term gain, have moved into a situation where the devastation of this that it causes for the people of the world in the long term is not being paid much attention to. If you think about the fact, as I believe it was Oxfam recently reported, that 80 individuals in the world control as much wealth as nearly 4 billion, the poorest half of the population of the Earth, that is a problem that is obscene. The result of that problem is manifested all around us, both in terms of the ecological devastation that comes from a runaway system looking to maximize profit at every point, to the impending wars that are taking place all around the world, to the massive gross inequality that causes people who have every capacity to do for themselves not to be able to do so because they are denied access to the very means of life that they need in order to be able to do for themselves. I think an outlook that begins with a sense of optimism and faith in humanity, which is that, one, these are problems that we have created, and therefore these are problems that we can solve, would lead us to looking at the need to democratize both the natural and the labor-built wealth in the world so that these resources are made available to the people of the world for the purpose of being able to meet our human needs and elevate the quality of life. Right now, I live in the U.S. South. This is an area where the production of cotton during the 19th century ended up providing some of the surplus and the profits that ended up fueling and funding the Industrial Revolution. So this is a part of the world where the extraction, where the incredibly brutal extraction of value from the labor of enslaved Africans ended up having a worldwide effect on helping to create this monstrous system that we live in now. So one of the projects we're working on is looking at ways to heal part of the damage that is a result of that devastation. We're creating a Southern Reparations Loan Fund along the lines of this idea of democratizing wealth, which is to say, put back into the hands of people under democratic control the wealth that they have created and connection to the earth itself. For democracy to work, it requires two things. One is access to good information, and the other is people thinking together. People thinking together with access to good information are capable of making good decisions. In fact, that's the best that we have. That's all that we have. Because we have all seen worlds in which experts have been purchased by people, owners of this wealth, in order to come up with all kind of expert solutions. So the expert information needs to be available. And that's one of the things I'm looking forward to as we hear more of this webinar, how the information, the visioning, the networking can put at the hands and the disposal of the people of the world the information required for the kind of democratic maintenance of the resources, which, again, we have to create new structures of ownership that allow for this ownership to be at the disposal and for the benefit of the peoples of the world rather than for the handful that are currently benefiting from them now. You know, in a single community, it can be as simple as the people in a neighborhood looking to create a grocery store in a food desert. That's one of the lower-level projects that we're working on here in Greensboro, North Carolina. But if you expand that, which is to say that people in every community ought to be able to make use of available resources to do what it is they do to create, to meet their needs, we see how the existing system mitigates against that by not having these resources easily and readily available, and instead offering people solutions that are no solutions at all. That if somehow we had more education, this would in and of itself transform the problem, when indeed the problem has to do with the allocation of resources and the lack of democratic control over the wealth of the world, both the natural wealth and that wealth that has been created by millennia of labor, by working, laboring people. That's it for me, Gus.
Good, thank you. Michelle and Fernanda, are you prepared to go ahead at this point so we can get you into the picture also? Why don't we start with Michelle Mascarenhas? She's with Movement Generation and leads the Justice and Ecology Project there, and also the Climate Justice Alliance, And over the past almost decade, as many of you know, Movement Generation has been trying to bridge the gap between our current social movement strategies and the scale of the ecological and other problems that we face. And I'd like to ask Michelle if she would go ahead at this point, please.
Sure. All right. I guess this is how the transition is going to be, right? Navigating the contradictions.
Yep.
Learning that over-reliance on technology and these global systems is really not what we want to count on. Not to say that this isn't an important effort at all, but I think it's just, you know, a reminder and a lesson that the scale of the problem does not dictate the scale of the solutions. And so really, you know, building off of what Ed started with, I was going to do some PowerPoint slides, but now I kind of feel like maybe not. So I think I'll just talk, and I'm happy to share slides later that folks can check out. At Movement Generation, over the past 5 years, we've been working with groups from around North America, especially from the U.S., and rooted in the San Francisco Bay Area, where we're based, to get at this this not just question, but this really challenge of our time, which is that we believe that it is the right of peoples to have the resources required for a productive, dignified, and sustainable livelihood. And so if that is the case, then we have to take right action in order to define and create the local living economies that we require in order to advance this transition towards the path of, the only path really, of human survival. And not just survival, but we believe that this is actually going to be that the process of people getting together and repairing relations, restoring the muscles of collectivism that have been completely forced out of us through colonization, that these are the important activities that we need to actually be engaging in. And so we've been developing then with the groups that we've been working with a just transition framework, strategy framework. And we, you know, core to this is really the idea that our movements have been operating on sort of parallel tracks. On the one side, we have forces that have gotten pretty good at campaigning and building sort of movement muscle to step to those in power and say, here's what we demand. Although, of course, those reforms are generally not as big and bold as we need them to be. And then on the other hand, we have folks that are working to address or to build the new, right? So to build the local living economies that we need to forge food sovereignty, systems of local food systems, to forge zero waste systems where that put people to work, that cost less money, that cut greenhouse gas emissions, and that, you know, reroute people in place in understanding our you know, our waste stream and our impact on the places that we live and depend on. Local energy systems, clean community controlled energy systems. But these sectors are often not necessarily coming together and linked. So the build the new and the building the power have not enough been done together. And so this is a core part of the Just Transition Strategy Framework, is that we've got to be building visionary and oppositional economy by changing the rules. That means making the rules that are going to chart or create a path of least resistance towards local living linked economies, rather than a path of least resistance towards this extractive economy that is destroying the life support systems of the planet and our peoples. And then so changing the rules, and that also means breaking the rules that are really illegitimate and that are huge barriers to our being able to forge a just transition. And then finally, we've got to build the new, we've got to change the rules, and we've got to move the resources. So core to all of this is, you know, really a lot of what Ed was naming, which is if capital is just the wealth that was generated by human labor and the natural resources of the living world, and that has been, you know, appropriated by really the 1%, those resources have to be drawn down into local communities and redistributed towards a just transition. And so this, we think, is core. So we've been active in building up also what's called the Reinvest Network. Ed is part of that, you know, a bunch of other folks, so student divestment forces, prison divestment forces, coming together with grassroots organizations and groups that have been innovating non-extractive finance mechanisms to really figure out how we move capital back into the commons, where people can access the resources needed for a productive, dignified, and sustainable livelihood. Starting, you know, in some ways I think of this as like the moment we need to moisten the sponge. We've got to get lots of hands on the ground in order to support communities restoring economy, restoring our own labor to meet our own needs in ways that actually contest for power, and change the story at the same time. So I think those are some of that's a kind of a snapshot of the Just Transition framework. I'm happy to give some like concrete examples of where these things are working together, especially in California, which is where I'm based and can share some of that. So I guess you just let me know how much time I have or if you want me to do that later.
Thank you. Why don't you put a couple of concrete examples out there.
Okay. Yeah, so I mean, one example I wanted to share is about clean energy. So one of the things that's happening in California, so in Richmond, California, it's the site of one of the most polluting refineries in the state, and on the West Coast, the Chevron refinery. Those communities have been battling that refinery for decades, and only in the past 10 years have they successfully mounted, you know, a sort of joint campaign to restore democracy. So there's been a majority of kind of Green Party and other progressive candidates that are not just completely owned by Chevron on the city, elected to the city council, that have been able to advance some progressive, you know, direction in the city council and the kind of policies that are being put forth. And at the same time, the community groups on the ground have been building up a cooperative incubator, so Richmond Cooperative Incubator. There's folks like I see the Sustainable Economies Law Center, Asian Pacific Environmental Network, Urban Tilth, Rich City Rides, the Richmond Progressive Alliance, and then the Energy Solidarity Cooperative that are all doing some very innovative things to support democratizing energy, basically. So they're looking at where can we find the synergy between community organizing that's happening on the ground and being able to install rooftop solar, even energy efficiency projects that can be scaled through municipal regulations that they've won to create what's called community choice aggregation, which allows for community members to buy power in bulk and choose the type of power that they're buying. So there's sort of on-the-ground projects, there's regional energy system reform that folks have won, And then at the same time, groups like Asian Pacific Environmental Network and other environmental justice groups in the state are working at the state level in Sacramento to create, to win regulations that are, or legislation, sorry, that are able to draw down resources into, for example, a bill was just passed in the last couple months at the State House to create a $10 billion fund over 10 years for multifamily affordable housing to have solar installed on it. So this is like a huge victory because tenants are almost never on the benefiting end of this so-called solar revolution. It's usually, you know, it's the financiers, number one, and occasionally the homeowners. But for working class tenants to really be able to benefit from large resource shifts required organizing. And so I think this is a really good example of organizing to change the rules, move the resources, and then also building the new. And I think where the sort of sticky but also you know, important part that we're navigating right now is some of it is about sequencing. So before we've got the money, how are we possibly able to build these kind of solar initiatives on the ground? And at the same time, until we've built these initiatives on the ground, if we don't do that first, we know that when the money moves, those that are best positioned to benefit from those resources are generally private contractors. You know, it's the solar city, it's the corporate-controlled solar industry that's just employing folks at you know, low wages where the community is not actually controlling that energy. And so this relationship between build the new, change the rules and move the money is a very it's a rich space for really trying to align our strategies. We know we need folks in different places, and we know we need to be coordinated and strategic at every moment. And so it's a very exciting moment, and with a rich with a lot of possibility.
That's fascinating. The question here from for Ed, it relates to what you were saying. Ed, the question is, and tell us some more about the reparations fund, how it's structured, how it's related to financial institutions, and any comments that you have on what Michelle is doing and Movement Generation is doing.
I worked very closely with Michelle and Movement Generation, and I think what they're doing is great. The work we're doing with the Southern Reparations Loan Fund, first of all, I want to place the loan fund somewhere, because someone said, well, if it's for reparations, why are you lending money? Why do you want the money back? The Southern Reparations Loan Fund is in the community. It's not something outside of it lending money into the community, then taking the money back. It's in the community as a way of bringing in resources, and then it creates the democratic structure within the community for the allocation of those resources in such a way as to go to benefit the community as a whole rather than benefit some handful of individual entrepreneurs or their agents. It is structured along the lines that we have learned in large part from the work of the working world in Latin America that is referred to as non-extractive finance. This has to do with looking at ways to make resources available to enterprises so that those resources help to enhance the enterprise in being more profitable and producing more surplus that can again meet the needs of people in the communities, but not extract from those enterprises resources beyond which those that were brought in. This whole non-extractive idea is very, very important because the overall nature of finance in the world today is that it is highly extractive, that it is one of the ways of consolidating and extracting labor from all around the world and concentrating it into very, very few hands. The idea of the reparations loan fund, as is the idea of the financial cooperative that we're working on nationally with a number of other groups, including Movement Generation and some others, there is a type of finance that can be created which is non-extractive in its very nature, so that it has principles of radical inclusivity, which is to say we're looking to make finance available to people that the normal financial structures would not touch. We will not refuse to make a loan into your enterprise or activity on the basis of who you are or what the history of your credit worthiness has been in the past, but rather on the viability of the project that you're working on. That rather than having a principle of maximizing profit, it has a principle of maximizing community benefit, which is to say that on the one hand, it can't squander the resource, the right now limited resources that we are able to draw into the Southern Reparations Loan Fund. We can't squander that on non-viable projects, but at the same time, we can't hoard that money in such a way as to preserve the assets and not take the risks that are necessary to have viable projects that need to be built inside communities. So with these principles of non-extractive finance, maximizing community benefit, and radical inclusivity, we're looking to model a type of financial activity that can attract people who have access to wealth, who are looking to put that wealth at the disposal of communities. Right now, we're looking to do this on a voluntary basis among people who are able and willing to participate in that activity. And as we grow power, as we grow our capacity to do so, we should be using our democratic power within the community to make sure that this is the fundamental way that our finance operates, rather than this predatory and extractive forms of finance that are taking place now.
At this point, I think it's a good point to bring in Fernanda Ibarra into the conversation, who's been quietly observing the rest of us. She's the co-founder of the Collective Intelligence Research Institute and is internationally recognized for her work in collective intelligence and its relation to the next economy. At the center of her work is the idea of a conscious evolution of social systems, a new social DNA. And we're delighted to have her with us and ask her to make a presentation at this point. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
Yeah, I want to share that the main organizations that I'm part of is Village Lab, and what we do is that regenerative design for communities of purpose, place, and practice, and the Metacurrency Project, which works a lot on the design of currencies and protocols and new compute platforms for the next economy. It's a big, big work on social computing that will allow for decentralized decision making in between and decentralized platforms of all sorts. But that's because, yeah, that bio was not as early. So just to share that little piece. And what I was asked before in our conversations via email was to share about the Real Economy Lab and how would it serve as a tool for us to be able to see the whole systems. And I really want to go into that question because it's such a beautiful effort, and I wish that people go really to realeconomylab.org, and they've been mapping the whole new economy ecosystem, and you can see the relationships in between the different projects as well as what are the topics that are emerging. And they develop a taxonomy, a very, very detailed ontology that will help us see and be aware of ourselves. So it's a tool for self-awareness. And even though the mapping is not the territory, and we're constantly reminded of that, we also need the map to be able to know how to navigate it. It's like if I go to Brazil, I would want to see a map to see where am I going. Once I know the map, I can throw away the map and I can continue. But because we live in such a space of transition, and because as Charles Einstein says, we are in a space in between stories, then mapping and seeing the map makes the story visible in a way that we can have a collective understanding of it. And this is a piece where in the Collective Intelligence Research Institute, we have studied a lot a concept that we call holapticism. And holapticism is a property where the parts are able to see the whole. So an example is a football team. You know, you have a football game. If you put the players like these, the players won't make smart decisions because they cannot see each other. Or if you have a jazz band and they put like each other's, they tap their ears and they cannot hear the other players of the jazz band, then they won't be able to improvise and make a good improvisation. So we need to see what is happening in the whole, what's happening in the system. And the more we're able to see that and able to see the flows of relationship and able to see as a movement and to see who is who and where are the players and what are the main purposes as organizations, I think that in the maps they call it explicit positions, what they're advocating for. Then we are not going to probably trace all the type of relationships that are going to happen, but we're all going to be able to see the actions that come out from it. So the reason why we don't have those holopticism is because we still don't have the technologies to be able to see it. We have some, and they're coming. Like an example could be of holopticism is the, yeah, the perfect one right now is really the real economy lab map in Kumeo. And one other aspect of those maps, if you see the map at first, once you see it, you'll probably feel a little confused, like what is what. But once you keep yourself with the map, you will be able to see what questions need to be asked, what questions need to be answered, what are the insights that emerge from that. And what are the language? I believe that part of why the reasons why we don't have a wider collaboration is because sometimes we speak different language, you know, and language needs translation. And language is, in collective intelligence, we call them invisible architectures. So thinking of invisible architectures like the DNA of a social organism, they are going to... Social outcomes come out of that DNA, the same way that in our body, our DNA will determine the color of our hair, of our eyes, and many other properties of my system. So in a social organism, the DNA is also going to be determined by those invisible architectures. So money is a big one, and language is a big one. We can create a shared understanding of that language and use the maps that we have now to say, okay, are we seeing Brazil the same way? Or is this mountain a little bit more to the east or the west? And have a shared understanding of that. Then we'll be able to move more rapidly. Otherwise, sometimes we're speaking about the same thing, but we're using different ways. Collaborative economy, sharing economy, solidarity economy. You know, we have so many language that is shifting so rapidly. And we use the word wealth differently. You know, in metacurrency, for us, wealth is much wider than money. And we have a living systems map of what wealth is, wealth that can be traded, wealth that can be measured, wealth that can only be acknowledged. And we believe that we have to restore its real meaning to that word. And we see it in all the workshops and conferences that we give, that people, when we ask them, what is wealth? Sometimes they mention money, but not all the time. They mention education, love, relationships, safety, water, you know, all these things. So language is an important thing. Another aspect I would say for theory of change that I hear that is one of the core aspects of the REL project is that in metacurrency we hold that to be able to make a whole systemic change, we have to understand living systems pretty well. And also, we have to trace the patterns of what had caused big changes in the past. And for us, that comes in, can be nailed into what we called new expressive capacity. And we can see new expressive capacity in the evolution of consciousness and the evolution of our species by thinking about a concrete example, like the writing. Right? Writing enabled a new expressive capacity. So we have a very limited set of letters, but we can compose it, that's composability, in millions of ways. And then we can have poetry, and we can have books, and we can have laws, and we can, it enabled a new expressive capacity for humanity that was not present before, and literally everything shifted. So, you know, language was the first, writing and printing press as well. Everything shifted. And right now we have the internet that's enabling a new expressive capacity. And we have a very limited language to speak about things like gifting. You know, people that are committed, like in Village Lab, we're very committed to gifting and generosity. We have trouble expressing a whole language of what gifting and generosity is, but we're coming into learning that. And it's a whole ontology in itself. It's really a powerful aspect of living something and then being able to express it because it's so new. And in Metacurrency Project, we think that as well as in the story of humanity, before language, people were doing like, eek, here comes the tiger. In this moment, with money and wealth and finance, we're in eek. We have to develop that language. We have to develop that writing. We have to develop that possibility to speak with one another. Yes, so there is a whole aspect of that work, but I want to give space to the others, and I feel completing that piece. If there's questions, I'm happy to answer.
Well, Fernanda, what would be a good thing for us to read to get this perspective on change and on the world as your organization sees it? Point us to something. Are there links on the website? Where should we go?
Thank you very much for that question, Gus. Well, we are preparing a paper Eric Harris Brown is writing on systems change and new expressive capacity, and it's going to come out soon. There's possibility to follow the work that we're doing in a website called sceptr.org, CEPTR.org. And there's a paper there called Scepter Revelation that explains a lot of what is our solution and our new compute platform and social computing for new expressive capacity. So it's kind of not the analysis, but the solution that we're creating. We are starting to come up with the content. We spend so much time creating the platform that right now is the moment to bring out the content, and we'll be having a deep wealth design with Arthur Brock and Eric Harris Brown in January, end of January, in the Bay Area, 3 days of deep wealth design. So we hope to cover that. And then I promise we'll share all video pieces and content and all that really needs to happen. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. And thank all of the presenters. A couple of questions have come in from our participants. And one of them has to do with the Bay Area. And the question is whether there's been a real economy lab type mapping of groups in the Bay Area. Has anyone focused this approach in the Bay Area particularly?
Should I go?
Yeah.
No, go ahead, Fernanda.
Thank you. The group I'm aware of is the TRCC, the how can I forget if I participate with them, is a Thriving and Resilience Communities Collaboratory, and they're doing a lot of good work with coalition building, and they're really into the intention of mapping, and they've been creating beautiful projects and papers about the next economy and localism and different types of organizations that are doing this work, particularly in the West Coast.
Give us the name again.
Thriving and Resilience Communities Collaboratory, TRCC. And it's an initiative of Leslie Meehan and Ben Roberts, which I saw here in the participants today.
Good. Michelle, did you have something to add to that?
Yeah, I mean, for us, the Our Power campaign has, so we're part of the TRC2, TRCC. We think that's a great initiative to try to bring folks who have, folks from the philanthropic sector, or folks who are able to, you know, move their own capital towards social movement activities along with movements to try to shift that those resources. And then the Our Power campaign is also working to build sort of hubs like Our Power communities in the different cities of the Bay Area. And I, for movement generation, that is towards, you know, ultimately we have to be shifting our understanding of the scales of governance towards right scale, which we think tends towards like the bioregion. So, so I think the Our Power campaign provides a space for folks to come together. And so there isn't mapping in the sense in the same way that, the sort of on available on the internet kind of mapping, but there's very concrete, you know, collaborative work that's happening in real time through that campaign.
Gus, one thing I would add is thriving resilient communities collaboratory is on the proof of concept map, which is available online already, as are movement generation. But the richness of how the Real Economy Lab meta maps develop is really down to people putting forward their organizations to be included in the meta mapping and filling out the survey. So we'd be delighted for people in the Bay Area to join what we're doing online and to fill out the survey, and then we can get them up on the hub online in the next round. Likewise, anyone else who's listening, that's one of the big call-outs from our end, is please do get involved in the meta-mapping, because it's only as rich as the number of organizations that are on there. And I think at some point, Gus, in a moment, my colleague Benjamin is going to be able to take people through the Kumu slides, just to give people a sense of these meta-maps and how they work online.
But not ready yet.
No. At some point, after Michelle Bowens, perhaps.
We also had an interesting question from the audience about the relevance of recently completed COP21, the climate conference of the parties, and whether it is it's viewed as an advance or setback. A number of us have discussed more local approaches, and including local approaches to new energy systems, to renewables, and local ownership of your own. And I know there's an effort underway to try to take the administration's clean power plan and implement it in a way locally that would create a lot more decentralization and local ownership and local control of energy systems. I'm just, so does anybody want to question?
Yep.
Anybody want to reflect on COP21 and these issues?
Yeah, I'd be happy to, Gus. I was there for the whole of last week, and I think what was really shocking to the NGOs and the Progressive Foundation, so I spent quite a lot of time with, for instance, the Edge Alliance, at FPH in Paris, at FPH's office, and with a lot of social movements. And what was really shocking is, as the week progressed last week, any mention of just transition language, of indigenous people's rights, of a lot of social dimensions of sustainable development were taken out of the main documents. Some remained in the preamble, but very few of those sorts of issues, which groups from the Global South, for instance, were fighting very hard to have in there, were taken out of the documents. And I think what we've seen, you know, it's about as good as we could have expected in terms of realpolitik, but in terms of the reality of what we know the just transition needs to be about, COP21 is not going to answer many of the challenges we confront. It's still reflective of the tanks and banks economy, as Michelle and Movement Generation would call it, rather than the future next economy we need to get to. So the answer really is don't look to our leaders, in inverted commas, to solve these issues. It's down to us, progressive grassroots movements, to solve these issues, and I think that's what we're all up to.
Other comments on the COP21 outcome and the link to renewable transition? Anyone else? Noel, I'm wondering if you have Michelle Bowen's item for us at this point. But I have a question from the audience, that we could certainly take up while the video is being prepared. The member of the audience says, I understand the critical need to map and discuss how the next system can be structured. However, what suggestions do you have for people who want to take action now? I mean, especially small local groups with few resources and much enthusiasm. People need action to get and stay involved. What do our panelists recommend? Who wants to start on that one?
I'm happy to say something initially. The other panelists are all involved in fantastic grassroots mobilization, and so I look to the work they're doing. But also there are lots of other organizations over here, particularly in the UK and in Europe. Transition Towns is a very active movement, which I know is now getting much more active in the US as well. So you could start your own transition town. There's all sorts of materials and experience from the Transition Towns movement over the last 5 years that people can seek to follow the lessons of, rather than having to reinvent the wheel. So there's all sorts of initiatives like Transition Towns, which I would suggest people should join up and start your own local group.
And there's certainly sites that have websites that have collected examples of local initiatives that can be replicated. Many of the groups on this call, I think, have collections of local initiatives. I know that the Democracy Collaborative does, and Naomi Klein created Beautiful Solutions site, which is, and there are others who can, you know, we would point to, but perhaps our panelists have some specific suggestions about that, since you are deeply engaged locally. What would you advise?
I want to say something briefly. Yeah. The key to any of our work is building authentic democracy in the communities where we are. I've talked to any number of organizers or people who call themselves organizers who talk about doing things in communities that they don't have many links with. And I typically tell them that until you get there and develop some really close links and help to identify the organizational structures that actually exist, you're not going to be very successful. Once you're able to do that, it's about trying to enlist people in working on things that meet their needs within the community and then confronting the obstacles. There are ways to struggle for local government to be more involved than it is in helping people meet their needs. Local governments right now, typically in case of market failures, will come up with incentives to help guarantee the profitability to an individual entrepreneur in order to hope that some social benefit trickles down from his successful money making. In a similar kind of way, that local community could guarantee the likelihood of success of an initiative that is developed within a community by community members. And people have to continue to do that. And then we look to structure and institutionalize to the extent possible the systems by which we can structure gaining the resources for those initiatives. One of the criticisms that I saw in the list of comments after I had spoken briefly about a local initiative was that here we are talking about local stuff that doesn't meet up to the scale of the problem. The scale of the problem is that in every locale, people's local needs are not being met. And so that as we build examples that people can look to, I mean, it's a national problem in this country that there are food deserts all across the country where people have a hard time accessing healthy food. At one point, the cooperative movement in this country, as progressive as it is in so many ways, said that the food co-op movement in particular was saying that it had no solution to that because a lot of those communities were too poor, too black, too uneducated to build a food co-op. Well, this is a ridiculous answer, and in fact, we went ahead to work toward building one in this community to set as an example for the thousands of communities across the country that you can do that. And then the structures by which local government is enlisted, by which non-extractive financial financing organizations are created, become a part of how it is that we work toward meeting people's concrete needs and alleviating the pain and suffering that people face in the system as it exists. The system has its own inherent contradictions, and many of us feel that we are in a system that is in crisis that will have to make some big changes. We don't have to make all of the changes to be made to the system. The system cannot continue in the way that it is going. What we have to do is create examples of what is possible. What is it that the people are capable of doing for themselves in restructuring a new system that is more aligned with meeting people's needs and elevating the quality of life in our community? And we do that one community at a time, even as we try to find those lessons that can be shared across the globe.
Michelle, I sense that you had something you wanted to add to this conversation.
Me?
Yes.
Michelle?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, that was great. I totally agree with that. So, you know, here we are in the U.S. Donald Trump is an actual contender for presidency of this land. And I think that the rhetoric that he's advancing or playing to speaks to this very deep dissonance that people feel across race, across class strata, that the system is completely broken and that the government as it has it structured is not set up to meet people's needs. And so it is a real opportunity to, I mean, what we find when we lay out the banks and tanks, you know, unveil the banks and tanks economy to folks in workshops, in rooms of people that are, you know, again, cross-class strata, cross-race strata, is that people get it. And the question is, do we trust people to actually, you know, apply our own labor to build a new economy? And not just labor. When I say labor, I mean like fully embodied human beings, not the kind of drones that this economy tries to, you know, has forced us to become. And I trust us. Like, I think that our work at the local levels is about organizing, number one. So it's about talking to folks about what's really going on, supporting the building of a shared political analysis of the root causes of the problems, which I believe are actually, you know, just almost like right there on the surface with most folks. And but then it has to go towards, like, there is vision. And we have to cultivate that vision as we're building these projects of economic democracy, of democratization of the economy. So I think that that's where it starts. So, I mean, just very concretely, it starts, yeah, with where you are. So if you have access to people with capital, you're doing political education with those folks to understand that their interests are linked to the viability of frontline communities. And we see that with, you know, what's happening with the police, the prison industrial complex in this country, and police brutality. If you are linked to working class communities and communities of color, or Global South communities, you know your work is around similar things. It's political education, but it's also like, how do we actually restore our own labor to meet our own needs? So what I've learned, some of the brilliant efforts that I've learned about are, for example, the landless workers movement in Brazil is like a incredible model of how folks are organizing to meet their own needs for land, for education, for healthcare clinics, for childcare, and really in all of that is both a critical consciousness, like collective critical consciousness, that is being developed within that, and also self-governance. Yeah.
That's great. Thank you. Fernanda, you want to comment at this point too? Fernanda, can you hear me?
I can hear you, Gus. Thank you. Well, yeah, there's a lot of threats here and a lot to comment. I'm trying to see what is the point of access. Well, perhaps for me, one of the things I want to mention is that as we go and do different maps, because this is about mapping the new economy, right? So we're seeing that there are different maps that express things differently. I'm going to look for a link for the wealth living system wealth map so that people can understand that products and services are only a very small piece of the wealth that is available to all of us. You know, so we kind of, money does that. You know, money focuses on, if we cannot measure it with money, we cannot encode the value with money, then we don't know what to do. And we need to have ways of seeing all the other different levels of wealth. So, for example, I mean, it's clear what trading products and services and that type of wealth is. But the wealth that you can measure, you can say you can have a reputation as a wealth that you can measure. You know, you can measure your health, but you cannot really trade it, right? So there's wealth that is measurable but not tradable. And you can definitely, if I want to deal with your wealth, if I, you know, sell your organs, pretty creepy, then I have to get the whole, the health of the whole. And it's not only about, it's not health anymore. And we tend to do that in our economy, and that's the basis of an extractive economy, convert everything into scarcity or products and services. A great example for that is knowledge. You know, people think that knowledge is, or not think that, no, people think that, I'm not going to say that. Knowledge is abundant. But to make it, to be able to sell it with money, we have to create private property, right? Copyright. Mm-hmm. If we create copyright, then we can make it scarce, and then we can sell it. So my point with these different levels of wealth is that not all wealth is products and services, and not all wealth is even measurable as well. We have attempts of measuring what is the social impact of different organizations or initiatives, and we need that to be able to address the climate change. And we also have to be careful on what we measure, right? Our gross national product is a perfect example. If we keep measuring progress in regards to the products that we can produce, in regards to what we can produce and consume, then we're going to go directly into a finite game instead of an infinite game, which is what we're trying to create, you know, a world where my grandchildren can still be in the joy of life and in the abundance of the beauty that surrounds us. So I think that one of the main points that I want to make for the audience is that we tend to put scarcity in what is abundant and abundance in what is scarce, because our resources are scarce, our natural resources, and we have to be better in measuring those and have holopticism about how resources are being regenerated, which is a main point for Village Lab, is like sustainability is not enough. Sustainability says, oh, let's not damage the earth. but it doesn't say, let's regenerate the earth. So it's not enough to be able to manage our resources. So we have to be able to create regenerative ecosystems. We think that that's a new word, and it's also getting a lot of momentum. A year ago, it was nowhere, but now it's more of a common meme that we can see out there. So that's great news. I think that that's a point of access that is really, really important. As well, when we mentioned capital is not only money. The Meta Integral Institute, for example, has created a map about 10 forms of capital. From spiritual capital, psychological, knowledge, social, cultural, natural, financial, manufacturing, human, health. All those are forms of capital. And many of our communities do not have financial capital, but they're wealthy in human capital. They're wealthy in natural capital. They're wealthy in cultural and social and knowledge and psychological capital, and especially when we see communities of place that have been doing a lot of the work, right, in enabling and enacting new economic systems. We have eco-villages that have 50 years sharing every dollar that comes in from the people in the community into the center, and then having decision making together to see where those resources are going to go, and they have to really see and have the flows of where they're needed as well, where those resources are needed. So we have great examples. It's just that not in enough scale. And one of the things that we really is part of our mission in Village Lab is to create a toroidal, what we call the toroidal field, which means doing not research and development belongs to institutions, but we want to do research and development, dissemination, replication, in a way that comes. Someone does that, some great initiative, we can disseminate it, spread it. Then if an initiative is vain in the Bay Area and they apply it in Brazil, it's going to be different because it's a different context, different culture, different people, different worldviews. So they can apply some of that learnings, but it will be different. Then they can create their own stories, share their own stories, because stories have consciousness in it. Stories have great examples in it. Share it again, back to the center and out into the network, so that we can constantly be doing these and make those different initiatives that work go from inside to outside, inside and outside, and grow. Because I believe there's not one single thing that works for everyone. I think that we need to see about particular contexts and initiatives. So that's what I would like to offer, and for now, thank you, Gus.
No, very beautiful. Very beautiful. I comment. I think we now have at long last Michelle Bowen's video for us. Benjamin, are you there? Can we play this? Can you play it for everyone, as you suggested?
Hello. Well, thanks to Jules Peck and the others who have invited me for this Next Economy project and the webinar. So my name is Michel Bowens from the P2P Foundation. And before I get into the solutions framing that I was asked to do, I need to say a few words about the specific point of view that we are taking at the P2P Foundation in regard to this next economy. So what we see is three different things. We see seed forms emerging that actually form another type of commons-oriented, commons-centric economy. So first of all, we see the emergence of global open design communities, which are now able to do through open contributory systems a massive scaling of cooperation and creating things like the Wikipedia, Arduino, Wikispeed, WikiHouse. So that's the first thing, these global open design communities as a new human institution. The second thing is we see around these commons two models. One is an extractive model of, you know, classic companies that have an extractive vision on how to maximize profits from these human and natural resources, and also from this knowledge. or generative business models from a new type of ethical entrepreneurs that seek to cooperate with the commons, with these global design communities, by creating livelihoods around these commons, and that enable people to continue this kind of contribution to shared resources. And a third human institution we see emerging is those of the for-benefit associations. So usually in these ecological systems, in these ecosystems, we see associations like the Inspire Foundation, the Linux Foundation, the Wikimedia Foundation, that enable and empower the infrastructure of cooperation. So this is an image, a summary image of a new type of economy where knowledge, techniques, and science is shared globally, where people are trying to make a living without destroying those commons, and where they find democratic solutions to all work together in this particular ecosystem. Now, some of the issues that we need to solve is, one is, I just mentioned, the extractive nature of some of the businesses that work around these commons. Think about Facebook. Great system if you think about how it enables all kinds of P2P cooperation, but none of the monetization is plowed back in the people who co-produce the value. Second problem is the non-engagement or the insufficient engagement of the alternative economy in these new models, which means that actually it's the extractive businesses which are reaping the benefits of that human cooperation. The lack of funding is a really huge problem. And generally speaking, the fragmentation. So let me now talk about the solution space as related to these issues. So here's a few things that I think we need to do. One is we need to converge different models. So we see people working on sustainability, saving the planet. We see people working on fairness, the solidarity economy, social justice. And we see people sharing knowledge and sharing eventually other resources. Within each of these streams, people are fragmented, let alone that the different streams work together. So one of the important things we need to think about is how can we converge so that we have a free, fair, and sustainable mode of production. And so things we work on in the P2P Foundation is, for example, open co-ops to converge the solidarity models with the open models, or the open source circular economy to converge the sustainability models with the open models. Second, ecosystemic thinking in territorial terms. So I think we should look at things like the Mutual Aid Network in Madison, Wisconsin, or En Commun in Lille in the north of France, which are attempts to look at the time bank, the food co-op, the credit union. How can they actually work together? How can they create an alternative stream of ethical value? So this is very important. Third, generative business models. One example I like very much is inspiral.org, in a New Zealand-based coalition of social entrepreneurs. They have a commons, Lumio, open source decision-making system. They have 18 business ventures that try to solve human and ecological issues, and they have a foundation that manages their common infrastructure. So we need to study and promote these post-corporate non-extractive models. So it's very important. This is a big part of the solution. We can't just rely on the old models, on the extractive models, to actually work in harmony with the commons. Defragmentation through policy would be another thing to look at. I think about the Bologna regulation for the care of the urban commons, where neighborhood collectives can propose policy to improve their neighborhoods, streets, and squares, with the city as an enabling mechanism. I think about sustainability empowerment platforms, where cities could create multi-stakeholder platforms that unite people that do non-toxic food, renewable energy, mobility commons, etc. So bring together all the good ethical actors in this new economy, bring together the user communities, and look at how to create integrated alternative ecosystems that replace the private supply chains. So a big role of policy and of cities and eventually larger territorial entities in this. A big issue also is funding. And there is a big paradox again that the venture capital extractive models are very aware of the benefits of the new sharing models. But ethical finance, for example, will not invest in peer production like WikiHouse or Wikispeed because they're asking for intellectual property as collateral. So we also need to solve the funding issue, find funding streams which can fund production projects that are free in terms of sharing, sustainable in terms of the physical ecosystems, and based on fairness in their reward systems. So a lot of things to do, but I think you know, knowing what to do is an important first step, and it's important that we unite and coordinate the alternatives, creating a maximum amount of mutual alignment. Thank you so much.
This is also a good occasion, if we can do it, to return to Jules. And are you ready, Jules, on the presentation of the slides?
I think Noel is going to put Benjamin on now to run through the Kumu. Is that right, Noel?
Yes.
Great.
Okay, yeah, I've got a short presentation I can walk through, which shows a little bit of the mapping that we've been doing on the Kumu platform here.
This is Benjamin Brown.
That's right, and I work with the MetaMaps project as part of the Real Economy Lab. I've been developing the maps here that you see as a proof of concept. So this is all information that's available on through our website and also directly on the Kumu platform. We'll get some links out to that. But this will give you a quick taste of what's possible there, and it is a really powerful platform to work with complex sets of information or systems. And there's a couple of important features. There's also a walkthrough video if anybody's interested in going into this a little deeper later on. That link is up in the blog section of our site. We'll pass that out just to get a better handle on how to work with Kumu. But the idea here is that we've gathered information from a number of organizations, around 50 here that you see in the center of the screen. These are coming from all over the world and all different sectors of experimentation and innovation, implementation in the field of new economic theory and practice. And the survey had a number of questions corresponding to about 10 or 12 different data types, and those are the attributes that show up on the map here. I've got this filtered down just to show the actors to start from a simple central view, and we'll add in a couple of attributes to see how that shows up on the map and how we can work with that by filtering and focusing to find useful information and insights. By clicking on any of the organizations on the map, you get the panel with more detailed info on the left-hand side. But then as we add in the attributes, you'll see these show up on the map connected to each organization as sort of a field or array. And each of these icons here represents one of the attributes that they selected on the survey that's then tied to the organization. And they're color-coded. There's a little legend in the lower left-hand side that shows the correspondence to the specific questions. So we've got questions from the survey about what is the organization's work area, sector of influence, primary output of their work, the means and mechanisms that they are achieving those outcomes, and explicit position and political economic paradigm as some other complements there. So this gives the full spectrum of attributes around one organization, and you can view that on the whole map for all of them, and it's quite a spaghetti mess. So that's why we're going to look at a couple of the features in Kumu that allow you to clean that up and find what's most relevant. What you're seeing here is a filtered view. Now I've selected down to just three attribute types. The green is the primary output. Blue is an explicit position that the organization endorses, and the gray is a sector of influence. So we're looking here at the P2P Foundation, Michelle Bowen's organization. And now what we can do is, based on those attributes that correspond, that come from the P2P Foundation, we can see all the connections to other organizations on the map that shared those attributes, at least one of them. And that's all of the links that you see, the fainter lines on the map showing up here that show those connections. And as you can see, if we zoom out, almost every organization that we've surveyed so far has some connection back to the peer-to-peer foundation, some common ground, some intersection on one of these attribute points that we've selected for, which is an interesting insight already, that if you look at just a small subset of all the different kind of parameters that we're talking about in this field of activity, the ecosystem, you quickly come up with a wide range of connections and opportunities for collaboration and convergence potentially arising out of that. Now, out of this set that the Peer-to-Peer Foundation chose, I'm interested in seeing which other organizations have adopted a number of those attributes so that we have a higher degree of overlap. And I'll go through a couple of quick steps just to show how that comes up in visual form. This view shows selecting for one in the middle. That's a primary output of new thinking and theory, something that Peer-to-Peer Foundation is very strong in, as we just heard from Michelle, and obviously something that connects to a number of other organizations on the map as well. I've selected two more now. This is to refine a more specific query. So we're looking at organizations that are operating or that have they're working towards an influence in the sector of community and grassroots that are holding an explicit position towards restricting capitalism, and that their primary output is new thinking and theory. So now we see the map that shows all the connections to those three specific attributes. And what we can do from there is find out which organizations actually share all three of them, so that there's a match between in all those areas. And that creates a bit of a storyline that we could think about each organization in their work and their role in this larger ecosystem is kind of playing out multiple storylines. And this is one example of how it could start to lay that out on the map here and find the connections or the commonalities in those between those stories. So here are the four organizations, or the three others, that share those three same attributes or that storyline in the ecosystem. And we can and then jump back out to a wider view, which shows all the other attributes connected to those four organizations, and really gives you a sense of the kinds of clustering that crop up around a specific storyline like that. And there's a number of other attributes that you see here that are in common and shared by those four organizations. So this might be the start of perhaps a cluster or a thematic area of work and collaboration, a potential place to explore convergence and seeing how these organizations might work better together, what they might offer to one another. And then, you know, we could look at what are some of the gaps or the missing pieces in this or other sorts of configurations and areas of the ecosystem. And so that's the type of inquiry that you can do with this tool. There's a lot there to explore, and we want to continue to work with others and find out how this data can really facilitate drive forward convergent conversations amongst groups that are operating in the field, and also look at what are the missing pieces and the gaps that might need to be filled in order to create a more healthy, holistic system that can move forward as a movement and reach the goals that are set out as shared ultimate outcomes. So.
Wow, that's fascinating. Jules, do you want to add anything? I think I heard a moment ago an open invitation to groups to self-identify and fill out the questionnaire and participate.
That's right, absolutely. I mean, as I said, and as Ben has very amply showed there, this what Ben showed there is the proof of concept phase, really. We got about a 30% response rate from organizations that we went out to, and there's about 50 organizations on there. We'd hope to have at least 200 organizations in the first non-beta metamap that we put up, and that means that we, you know, let's say we get a higher rate of response of 50%, we still need to go out to 400 organizations around the world. So, you know, it's only going to be as useful a tool for us in the next economy space as the number of organizations who input data and information, and the quality of that information as well. So let's all get behind this, and you know, if those of you who are listening think this is going to be a useful tool for bringing us together and for catalyzing new change, which we think it is, then get on board. Yeah.
Great. Well, thank you. Noting that there's a lot of enthusiasm being expressed from the participants, the audience on this. We have just a few minutes, and we did have this little bit of time set aside to allow our panelists to have any closing remarks or reflections or suggestions that to conclude with. I don't know, and we might go back through the order in the you know, and start with Jules again on that, and. Then Ed, and so on through.
Okay, well, I mean, I've said a lot, really, so I'd like to leave more time for others, really, just to thank you for hosting us today, to thank Benjamin, who's done astonishing work with the MetaMaps, and to encourage everybody to get involved in the project, the Real Economy Lab initiative. As I said, you know, the more of us that are involved, it's like a wiki. It's only as good as the number of people involved and the quality of the involvement. So, yeah, that's all from me, really. Over to you.
Yeah, Ed?
And I can be very brief. I really appreciate having a chance to be a part of this. I'm certainly going to have to spend a lot more time looking at the MetaMaps and some of the other tools that were shared here. I hope that all of these can become tools for democracy, tools that actually help us think together, have the information that's required for making the kind of good decisions that people will have to make to ultimately create an economy that does serve our needs and elevate the quality of life. I think that the whole key to this, again, is going to be finding ways to democratize wealth, democratize those resources that we have in order to be the productive people that we are capable of being. But I have a lot of optimism that we are capable of doing that. I think Donald Trump will ultimately disappear out of the internal contradiction that is built up of the fact that he is not solving people's needs and elevating the quality of life. And I think that at some point people will come to realize that. I realize things like that don't happen by themselves. We all have to work hard to make sure that that is the case, but that we have a political power question to do in order to make the democratic decisions necessary to gain access to the resources required so that we can meet our own needs and elevate the quality of life within our communities, and that is the work that we are engaged in doing together.
Great. Thank you, Ed. Michelle.
All right. Yeah, thank you all so much for organizing this and inviting me to participate. I want to start off by just appreciating also a lot of chat going on, great questions, just so much richness of resources out there. There's a number of y'all that could have been on this panel as well. So looking forward to engaging with you all in other ways going forward. And to that end, I hope you'll like sign up on our e-blast, you know, send me an email if you have resources. I'm also looking at those online. And I'll share the pillars of economy and just transition framework with Noelle and Benjamin or whoever is going to, you know, be sending stuff out to you all after this. And then I think for a takeaway or just one maybe suggestion for the real economy lab in particular, I would be really excited to see if there was a way to get a little more concrete in one specific area, and that is where are these initiatives that are building the new in ways that are contesting for power. And I think those are, to me, like the critical, that's like a critical confluence that we need to be working together around translocally. So that's where the scale, you know, we're looking at this in a different kind of a, like it's not scale as in one big boulder, but scale as in a bag of marbles. And I think it's really important that we start to line up our efforts, the things like, you know, the main dairy farmers and Vermont dairy farmers who have been really contesting for their right to distribute raw milk from their farms, the rights of Mother Earth and rights of nature ordinances that are happening around the world, you know, fights for indigenous sovereignty and just like land-based reclamation. And then, you know, I mentioned the landless workers movement in Brazil. You know, there's a number of these kinds of initiatives that I think we can really learn from. But then we need more platforms to identify where can we actually start to identify the leverage points. You know, there's some hinges that I think we, if we can identify those leverage points and be working at those places translocally, that can help to, you know, open the floodgate, so to speak, towards the next economy. And I'm really excited to, you know, continue this work with all of you. And like Ed said, I have a ton of hope, you know, believe in people power and just the brilliance of our folks to step forward and remake an economy that is for life.
Wow. Wow. Thank you. Fernanda, you have the last word.
I have the last word. Thank you. I appreciate it. Well, gratefulness for what is being done for the next system project as well. I mean, I really have appreciated reading some of the papers that are online from you guys and the kind of analysis and thoughts and honoring of the different initiatives. And it's a big work ahead because there's not only a lot of initiatives going on that can keep coming, but it's also the capacity that we have all together to navigate emergence. So, you know, we are in this leading edge together, and we're trying to find what is that source of that source field of intelligence that is present right now, and that sometimes is not as tangible as we wish it was. But that projects at RHEL try to make it visible, and I think that is really outstanding. And then have all of our initiatives mapped there, and we could take the care to really learn from those that connect to us in the, you know, kind of purposes, common purposes, and what is the explicit positions that are calling RHEL. I think that we'll be able to leverage each other in a micro level and then in the macro. So, you know, I'm seeing a lot of collaboration coming up in the world and the questions that we have, and we're building that intelligence. It's not there. It's new. Never in the story of humanity there has been a moment like this one, where we're both seeing immense challenges that sometimes just feel like too enormous to address, and at the same time the magnificence of the emergence and the magnificence of the capacities that we're building and the new technologies coming and our consciousness rising, and everything is an opportunity. Every moment is an opportunity. And economics, for us, is juicy thing. It's really like even full of life. So I would want to create a call for people to just go out and do it. It's about your relationship to the neighbors. It's about how you relate to Earth. It's about how do you offer your own services. It's about what is the language that you use every day to really create a new system right here and right now. So I think that we have the technology and the consciousness to be able to move pretty fast. And there's something about the courage that seems to be a need for more courage to be able to go out and apply. And in permaculture, they say fail early, fail fast. And I think we're reinventing failure, because failure is not about lack of success. It's about creating the new and then seeing what doesn't work and then reinventing it and dynamically steering. So go out there and do it with your parents, with your partners, with your communities, with your neighbors. Connect to the different sharing economies and circular economies and projects that are there. Just test. It's really, we're going to fail a lot. And it's a high risk, and it's okay, because that's what pioneering means. So thank you for all of you, and I'm very inspired about these conversations and the potentials for it. So thank you for the invitation. It's been an honor to be with all of you. Thank you.
Well, thank all of you. What a wonderful, inspiring conversation we've had. I honestly haven't felt quite as hopeful and as motivated about things as I, since the early days in the 70s, when we all trumped up to the environmental movement and took off. There's so much good things going on now. And as was just said, this is a very special moment, very special opportunity. I hope this group will continue to stay together. And we'll use the information that from the sign-ups to help facilitate that. And thank all of you. It's time to go. I've enjoyed it. Thank you for this opportunity to moderate. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.